All of you back, right? Can you believe nowadays what is the power and potential with you? You finished chapters like risk assessment and internal control and the fraud, all both chapters in one go, right? So we see the entire content and the discussion over there, right? But obviously we have to keep on making the fine powder out of the stones, right? So rock into stone and stone into powder. And then they say, ma'am, are we doing construction work or are we studying audit over here, right? But whichever way you look at it, right? That is how you need to approach the subject. Each subject has its own demons, right? So you have to address those demons. You have to take care of those demons. Like, you know, in a subject like FM or something, obviously the respective faculties would guide you, but there is a risk, you know, of you don't knowing which formula is to be applied where and what is the stepwise working to be done or so. So then you know what strategy you need to follow for that subject over there. Then in law, you need to remember the provisions of law. In EIS, you need to remember the technical term. In accounts, you need to know the format in which the problems are required to be solved, how the adjustments and calculations are required to be done. And so each subject, you need to do the risk analysis, risk assessment procedure. And identify the risk for each subject, then do the further audit procedure. That means respond to the risk. And so now you say, oh, FM formula problem, so prepare a chart of those formula. Audit writing problem, start writing one page every day. Right? If EIS, I don't get the technical term, again, what you do, start reading and, you know, revising those technical terms again and again. And after all that, you will obtain the sufficient appropriate audit evidence. And then you can express an opinion saying true and fair view. You understand? So the same strategy, you know, you have to apply for your study also. Okay, you have to evaluate, okay, what is the risk area? Don't be in your comfort zone. You know, I'm good with this chapter, so keep on studying that chapter. I'm good with this subject, so I keep on studying that subject. Rather, that subject, that topic, that chapter will come towards the end, because anyways, you're good at it. And so whatever you don't like, whatever is your least favorite, whatever you're very scared of, all those demons you have to address first, because if the demons are killed, only then the God will come. You understand? No. Right? So don't try to run away. Don't try to, you know, have a lack of confidence or always demotivating or always negative or always looking at the burden. See, one thing we say, okay, oh, we need to, you know, we require, you know, it's like half glass full or half glass empty, that type of a situation. One thing we say, oh, there are 40 marks required to pass. Another way, okay, there are only 40 marks required to pass. So the way you look at it, you don't require 75 out of 100 to pass. Just imagine, thank God ke the passing percentage is, you know, the passing requirement is 40 and obviously with the aggregate it is 50. So the way you look at it, it's not like a CPA exam where the passing percentage of the passing marks required are 75 marks for each subject. So it's not 75 out of 100. Here it is 40 out of 100 or 50 out of 100. But obviously getting that 40, 50 is also not an easy task. I do understand and acknowledge that fact over there. But then why just create the fear and the bubble of the fear and everything if it is not going to lead to anything productive? And right now you're just at the intermediate step, the stage. Okay, the more you prepare, the more you have the right programming in your brain, the more you have the right attitude and approach towards the study of the subject, right? That will help you very, you know, quick, you to, you know, prepare well for the CA final exams also. Because CA final, the danger, the trouble, the complexity doubles of what is there at the intermediate level. But intermediate, it makes you seasoned, you know, to what is CA course. Foundation doesn't do that. Foundation just takes you into the CA course. It says, come, it's your cup of tea. Intermediate decides whether it's really your cup of tea or not your cup of tea. Right? So then intermediate level, if you're able to, you know, identify the demons and develop your confidence and have the right programming in your brain, it won't take time for you to clear CA final exams. I've seen students, you know, who at intermediate, maybe they, you know, first they decide to write both groups, then they say, no, I can't write both groups, I need to write one group. Then they identify what mistake happened. So 3, 4, 5 attempts, you know, they keep on learning from the mistake. But finally, all mistakes over, so then they have to pass. Right? So CA final, directly they apply their learnings from the intermediate and they can clear the exams. Okay, I'm not at all, obviously nobody wants to write an exam again. Nobody wants to fail. Anybody sitting in the class, anybody listening to me, does anybody want to fail? Obviously not. Does everybody want to pass? I mean, it's so obvious. You can't write an exam without having an objective of passing in the exam. But that's the truth of the CA course. If 20% of the students clear, there is no option but for 80% of them not to clear. Right? So I always tell my students, okay, failing is normal in a CA course, passing is abnormal. Because if you fail, you are in the majority. You understand? No, it is like what is happening with the world is happening with you. You know, because it's normal to fail in a CA course. So obviously, if you want to pass, you have to be abnormal. So obviously, you have to study also abnormally. And you have to study out of the way. Like if you notice these days, you know, when we are studying over here from 9:30 to almost 4:35 over there, how the day just gets over? Are you realizing it? And how we can, you know, if we maintain a particular discipline, a particular momentum of the class, we can achieve whatever we've decided for that particular day, almost we can achieve. Right? We at the end of the day or at the end of the class, we have a satisfaction that I've studied so much and so, yes, so much I have done already. So every day when you also prepare a timetable for yourself, you should put in a lot of effort over there. Okay, right. So now that we've completed with the two chapters over there, that is number 4 and 5 as per our book. Now we come to the next two chapters over there, which is regarding the audit quality control, the audit documentation, and then the audit strategy, audit planning, and the audit program. Okay, right. So later on when you will do your articleship, and say mainly if you do your articleship in a big four, you'll remember about all this, you know, oh yeah, intermediate audit, there was all this, you know, audit quality control, audit documentation, audit strategy, audit planning, and the audit program. Okay, right. So now coming first to the discussion on the audit quality control, and then talking about the audit documentation. So which are the standards which are there for quality control? SQC 1, right, and SA 220, right? What is the title of SQC 1? Quality control for firms. That means this standard is applicable to the entire CA firm that perform audits and reviews of historical financial information and other assurance and related services engagement. So SQC 1 applicable to the entire CA firm, and SA 220, what is the title? Quality control for an audit of financial statements, right? Quality control for an audit of financial statements. So each and every audit done by your firm, there has to be quality in the audit done by your firm. And obviously, if there is quality in each and every audit, then there will be quality of the firm also. You know, if say firm is doing 20 audits, if all 20 audits there is quality, then we can say that all the engagements done by the firm also there is the quality, right? So in the exam, if the question is asked at the firm level, you write SQC 1. If it is asked at the audit level, you write SA 220. Best option as per SA 220 read along with SQC 1. As per SA 220 read along with the SQC 1, right? So quality control for firm, quality control for an audit. What are the objectives? Why they are saying there should be quality control, right? To achieve two objectives. One, that your firm, you know, because SQC 1 is for the firm, performs the engagement, whatever audit, review, assurance related services engagement, in accordance with the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement, PSLR. What is PSLR over here? Professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement. And second, the reports issued by the firm, because what is ultimately the deliverable of your firm? The audit report or the engagement report issued, whether the reports issued by the firm, are they appropriate in the circumstances? So why there should be quality control? You know, just can I not do the work as I wish? It says no. Why there should be quality? One, you cannot do the work as you wish. You have to do the work as per the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement. And second, your report has to be appropriate, right? The report, the deliverable of the auditor of the firm, that has to be appropriate. What are the objectives of SQC 1? That the firm complies with the PSLR and the firm's reports issued are appropriate in these circumstances. Can we think of what will be the objectives of SA 220? That the audit complies with the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement, and the auditor's reports issued are appropriate in the circumstances. What did I tell you? What is discussed in SQC 1 at the firm level? Same thing discussed in SA 220 at the audit level. Are you understanding, everyone? Right, so what does SQC 1 say? That the firm complies with the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement, that the firm's reports issued are appropriate. And what does SA 220 say? That the audit complies with the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement, and the audit reports issued are appropriate in these circumstances. Is it clear to everyone? Okay, right. So say if CA is going at the client place, right? So client place, do I understand the entity and its environment? Yes. As a part of understanding the entity, do I understand the internal control system? Do we understand the internal control system? Yes. What are the components of the internal control system? CRISM. We discussed that today. So at the client place, at Infosys, at Tata Motors, at Zomato, at Myntra, at Byju's, what there should be? Internal control system. And in the CA firm, which is going for doing the audit, there should be a quality control system. In the CA firm, which is going, so PwC, KPMG, EY, Deloitte. See, quality control system has to be in all CA firms. I'm just giving an example of Big Four. Right? All CA firms have to comply with SQC1. So in the CA firm, there should be a quality control system. What are the elements of the quality control system? LEHIM. Right? What are the elements of the quality control system over there? LEHIM. What do you mean by LEHIM? One, leadership responsibilities for quality within the firm. Right? Then there should be policies and procedures to ensure compliance with the ethical requirements, including the independence. Right? LEHIM. So for your firm, should there be somebody who is responsible to ensure that your firm complies with SQC1? Should there be, said Deloitte, should there be somebody in Deloitte who is responsible to ensure compliance with SQC1? Right, so the CEO, the managing partner of the firm, he will be responsible. Then should, system means what? Today only we said. System means policies and procedures. So there should be policies and procedures in the firm to ensure that the CA, the auditor, complies with the ethical requirements, including the independence and ethical requirement. So can I do an audit if I cannot comply with ethical requirement? No. You remember that? Integrity, objectivity, PCDC, confidentiality and professional behavior. Independence, do you remember? Threats to independence, then take steps to reduce or eliminate. And if you cannot, then not to accept the engagement. And be and appear to be independent. Do you remember all that? So there should be policies and procedure. Then there should be policies and procedures in your firm for acceptance and continuance of client relationship, acceptance of a new client and continuance of an existing client. So acceptance and continuance of the client relationship. Then there should be policies and procedures in the firm regarding the human resources. That is all the CA, all the articles, all the staff working in your firm. Right, human resources. Then there should be policies and procedures in your firm regarding the engagement performance. Okay, because finally, how you'll say, oh, PwC, they do very good audit, or KPMG, they do very good audit on the basis of how they perform the engagement, how they do the audit. So engagement performance. And last but not the least, there should be a monitoring. That is, pick up, say during the year Deloitte did 400 audits. Out of that, pick up 2 audits and check whether there was quality in those audits or no. So what is it? You're doing the monitoring of the quality control system. You're doing the TOC. You're checking the operating effectiveness. Right? Operating effectiveness. Right? So now, once again, listen to me. What did I tell you? SQC1, SA220. SQC1 applicable to the entire firm. SA220 applicable for a particular audit. What are the objectives? One, to ensure that the firm or the audit complies with the PSLR, professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement, and the reports issued are appropriate in the circumstances. Are you getting that? Then what are the elements of the quality control system? LEHIM, leadership responsibility, ethical requirements, then the acceptance, continuance of client relationship, human resources, engagement, performance, and the monitoring. Right. So what are the objectives of SQC1? Right. The objectives of SQC1, PSLR. Firm performs the engagement as per the PSLR, and the firm's reports issued are appropriate in the circumstances. And what are the elements of the quality control system? LEHIM. What does L stand for? Leadership responsibility. E stands for ethical requirements, including independence. A for acceptance, continuance of client relationship. H for human resources. E for engagement performance. And M for the monitoring. That's it. After that, you have SA230 audit documentation. You see it over there, right? So that's the LEHIM over there, right? Let's look at the question bank. Our question bank is always beautiful. Why? Because one wholesale question, elements of a system of quality control. Then leadership responsibility, one time asked in exam. Then acceptance, continuance of the client relationship. Then human resources. Then engagement performance. Again, a question on engagement performance and monitoring. And monitoring. Are you able to understand that? Right? So SQC 1, SA 2, 20. What you have to remember? One, the two objectives. What are the two objectives? PSLR and report issued as appropriate. PSLR, firm complies, performs the engagement in accordance with the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement. And second, that the firm's reports issued are appropriate in these circumstances. And then what are the elements over there? LEHEM, right? So now first coming to the first one. What is L?
Leadership.
The leadership responsibility. What the leader has to ensure? That there is quality on the each audit engagement. Now, quickly tell me, for the entire firm, who will be the leader? For the entire firm, so entire, for entire Deloitte, for entire PwC, the CEO, the managing partner of the firm, he will be the leader for the entire firm. And for a particular audit, who will be the leader? The engagement partner, right? The partners who are working on that particular assignment, they will be the leader for a particular audit, right? So it says the actions of the engagement partner. So now we are talking about a particular audit. That is why they write 220. But you know, if it is firm, then it is SQC 1. If it is audit, then it is SA 220, right? So what does it say? Who will take the responsibility for overall quality on each engagement? The engagement partner. So now, what is the importance of the audit quality? Number one, that the work is done as you wish. No, the work should be done as per the PSLR. Then for PSLR, the firm should be having the QCPP. What is QCPP? Quality control policies and procedures. Then the reports issued are appropriate, and they should be able to raise concern without the fear of reprisal. That is, I know that this employee of the firm is not doing the work properly. I know this employee of the firm big mouth in a breaching confidentiality, disclosing the secrets of the client. So now should I bring it to the attention of the engagement partner? Yes, like whistleblower. No, no. But then what I am scared, ke, oh, if I tell about this employee, that employee, they might take an action against me. It says, don't worry, without the fear of the reprisal. Right. So pink color is what? Pink color is nothing but the objectives of the standard. Are you getting? That is the objectives. Are the objectives ka point there in the leadership responsibility? Yes. In addition to that, what are two more points? QCPP and raise concerns without the fear of the reprisals, right? Without the fear of it bouncing back to you, right? Without the fear of the reprisal, an engagement partner has to take the responsibility. Okay, right. Then ethical requirements. What does it say? Ethical requirements, including those pertaining to independence. What are those? Integrity, objectivity, PCDC, confidentiality, and professional behavior. And not only independence of mind, but also the independence in the appearance. Are you understanding, everyone? Right. Then next one. Acceptance, continuance of the client relationship. Acceptance for a new client and continuance for an existing client, right? So now, say, you know, they say, okay, Baiju's want to appoint you as an auditor, Ferns and Petal wants to appoint you as an auditor, or say some, you know, like say some new organization over there, right? Some new type of company which has just come up over there, they want to appoint you as an auditor, right? So say Nykaa wants to appoint you as an auditor, Go Colors want to appoint you as an auditor, Reliance wants to appoint you as an auditor. So now will you immediately say, oh yeah, Reliance wants to appoint me as an auditor, come, come, please appoint me? No. You will do your homework. Do you will check the check certain points as per the quality control policies and procedures of your firm? What is the first ethical requirement for a CA? What is the first ethical requirement? If I am an auditor of a company, first thing, I should be a person of integrity. Auditor says same pinch. Client first requirement for me, that client should also be a person of integrity. If you want my integrity, even you should be having integrity. Right, integrity of the client's principal owners, key management, and the TCWG. They should not be known for doing frauds. You know, okay, oh, this company, they are always involved in money laundering and criminal activity. Then you say, no, no, I'm not coming for your audit. So not coming for your audit means I'm not accepting your audit, or I'm not continuing with your audit. Second, it's the man, say you are to be appointed as the auditor of Reliance. There should be at least 80 people in your team. And 80, you know, they say there should be 80 chartered accountants. There need to be 40 articles on the assignment. Yes, you require at least 20 days time to do that audit or so. But you say, I don't have the time. I don't have the resources to do the audit. So should you accept the audit? Should you accept the audit? No. So what does it say? Whether you have the CCTR. What is CCTR? The competence, capability, time, and resources to perform the engagement. So first what you check is the integrity of the management. You say people are very good. Then you need to check whether you have the CCTR, the competence, capability, time and resources. You say, yeah, yeah, we have 80 people. I have 20 days time to do this audit. I can do this audit. Next, check whether you can comply with the ethical requirements. Again, you can't comply with ethical requirements. No accepting the audit. Right? If there is any threat to independence, again, no accepting the audit. And also any significant matters raised during the current or previous audit engagement. So last year they had imposed a limitation on scope. You know, this year also I go, they will trouble me. They'll say that, you know, no information of inventory, no information for fixed asset. You say, I don't want only this client. Right? So significant matters which have been raised during the current or the previous audit engagement. Are you understanding each of this answer? What am I deciding? No, no, I don't want to accept the audit. When I don't want to accept, people are not good. Integrity not there. I don't have the CCTR, competence, capability, time and resources. I am not able to comply with the ethical requirements, including independence. Or last year, this client was a big headache. So this year, I don't want to do this audit. So it's obviously, if I don't want to do the audit, I am not going to accept the audit or not going to continue with the audit. Has the question come in your exams? Yes. Right. So acceptance, continuance of the client relationship. Next one, human resources, because that's the biggest, you know, asset of the CA firm. All the people working in the firm, like if you see Deloitte India, they have some 4,000 chartered accountants working for them. Right. So 4,000 chartered accountants, those are their human resources. And again, for the human resources, what should be there? Policies and procedures. Okay, all your people, all the 4,000 CAs in your work have the competent, even the articles. I'm just giving an example. All the people in your firm have the competence, capability, the commitment to ethical principle. Why? So that they can, right? So one, they, all the people working in your firm, they should have the competence, capability and the commitment to ethical principles. One, so that they can do the audit as per the PSLR. And second, that the reports issued are appropriate. So again, have I used the pink color? Pink color where originally I used in the objective. Same points replicated in the leadership. Same points replicated in the human resources. Okay, why I should have good people in my firm? Only then I can comply with the PSLR and the reports issued will be appropriate. And then PS, what does it say? What should be the policies and procedures for human resources? One, the recruitment. And an interview. And you have the interviews of the big fours and all of that whenever you have to join any CA firm. Right? Then once you join the firm, then after that, they will do your performance evaluation. They will check your, what do you say, accordingly decide your bonus, promotion, increment, and so. Right? So recruitment, then your performance evaluation, then competence, capability, and the capability, competence, and the career development. Then your promotion. Based on your performance, they will decide your promotion. Based on your promotion, they will decide your compensation. And also, like sometimes you see, oh, right now Deloitte is recruiting or PwC is recruiting. Why they are recruiting? Because they require more people. They are getting some new engagement. That is why they require the more people. So that's the estimation of the personal need. Right? So these are the human resource policies with respect to recruitment, then with respect to performance evaluation, then competence, capability, and the career development, then the promotion, then the compensation, and the estimation of the personal need. Are you getting that? Human resources. Next one, engagement performance. Again, what it says, there should be policies and procedures to give you reasonable assurance that engagement are performed in accordance with the professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement. Reports issued are appropriate. I have not made it same. It is the same. I'm just showing it to you. Okay, why you should do engagement properly? So that you do the work as per the PSLR and reports issued are appropriate, right? So again, what does it say? For there should be proper written or electronic manual, software tools regarding how to do the audit, right? There should be the guidance material. And what should be the guidance with respect to what are the matters for engagement performance? How engagement teams are briefed on the engagement to obtain an understanding of the objective. You know, somewhere I had discussed with you, ETD. Engagement team discussion, where? Bank audit. And when you start with the bank audit, there is an engagement team discussion. We said, what are the matters they discuss and what are the advantages of such a discussion? So here also, when you have to now start doing the Reliance audit or the State Bank of India audit, for there has to be a briefing. How engagement team are briefed on the engagement to obtain an understanding of the objective. Then can they do the work as they wish? No, they need to do the work as per the standards. Then also engagement, supervision. So first you give them the direction, then the supervision, and then the review. And first you give them the briefing. So that is nothing but the direction. Then after the direction, are they doing the work as expected? So that is the supervision. And after the work is done, the work of a less experienced team member is checked by a more experienced team member. So that is the review. So methods of review of the work. Then also obviously very important in your audit form is to maintain the adequate documentation and to ensure that all these policies and procedures are current. Current means they are right now being followed. Right? When you're actually doing the audit and not that they are just there in black and white, nobody follows them. Right. Then what does it say? Again, there should be policies and procedures for monitoring, okay, whether all this L-E-A-H-E, whether all this is being followed or is it just like black and white? It says, no, no, ma'am, we don't check acceptance, anything. Anybody says that, you know, please do our audit. We say, come, come, we'll do the audit for you. So come, come, we'll do the audit for you. That means you're not following the policies and procedures for acceptance, continuance of client relationship. Are you understanding? Right. So what does it say? Monitoring, a periodic inspection of a few selected engagement. Again, why are you doing that evaluation? Professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement. Also to ensure that the reports issued are appropriate. Record, no? So many times, same point coming over there. Also, what does it say? Quality control system, whether it has been designed and effectively implemented. Again, QCPP. What is QCPP? Quality control policies and procedures and appropriate firm personnel. Follow up. So take the necessary modifications to the QCPP. So you come to know that some policies are not proper. So when they make a change, yes, so again, follow-up action, whether the modifications have been done. Right, follow-up actions, whether the modifications have been done. Are you able to understand everyone? Right, see, otherwise, when you read all this, it looks like, what are they writing? What is all this? L-E-A, you know, monitoring and all of that. But now, do you understand? And at least what you will write in your answer? Professional standards, legal regulatory requirement, and the reports issued are appropriate in these circumstances. There should be QCPP. What is QCPP? Quality control policies and procedures in the CA firm. That's what I taught you. And then when you see L-E-A-H-E-M, you know those are the elements of the quality control system. Okay. Now coming to the next standard over there, SA-230, which is regarding the audit documentation. And it is so said that work not documented is work not done. Right, so work, you said, oh my God, ma'am, today how much work I did in the audit. I ask you, do you have documentation? You say no. Then it will be considered as if you wasted your day today. No work was done by you. Because work not documented is work not done. Right, so audit documentation. Right, in a very brief and technical manner, listen to me. If in a very brief and technical manner, if I want to tell anybody, hey, what we do in audit, they say you go 9 o'clock in the morning, you come at 12 o'clock in the night, what you do whole day in the audit? So you tell them, see, I'll tell you. First, what we do, we perform the audit procedures. Now, when I say audit procedure, that itself means the entire story of audit, risk assessment, TOC, substantive. Then what happens after performing those procedures? We obtain the evidence. And based on the evidence, we reach a conclusion. This is what we do in the audit. Am I right? We perform procedures, we obtain evidence, and based on the evidence, we reach the conclusion. Is it in a very brief and technical manner I have told what we do in an audit? We perform procedures. Based on that, we obtain the evidence, and based on that, we reach the conclusion. If you keep a record of these three, then that is audit documentation. What is audit documentation? It is a record of audit procedures performed, evidence obtained, and conclusion reached. Right? So say I have a 2 TB file, you know, some hard disk I have, and I say all Geo Limited documentation is in this file, or I have some hard file also. It can be combination of soft and hard file. I have these 4 box files over here. Does anybody ask, what is there in these 4 hard files or this 2 TB soft file over here? So what is in it? The record of the audit procedures performed, the evidence obtained, and the conclusions reached. Are you able to understand that? Okay. Right. That is audit documentation. Right. First, the definition. It is a record of audit procedures perform, evidence obtained, and the conclusion the auditor reach. And obviously the word working paper or work paper, every paper in the audit file is called as the working paper or the work paper. Okay, right, next question over there, the nature and purpose of the audit documentation. Okay, why audit documentation? Why can I not just check it? Why do I need to document what I have checked? Right, why can I not just check it? Why I need to document what I check, right? So audit documentation, the next question three times in your exam. What is audit documentation and what is the nature and purpose of audit documentation? Are you getting this question? Nature and purpose, why audit documentation? Right, why you need to document? Okay, right, so what is the title of 200? Overall objectives of the independent auditor and the conduct of an audit in accordance with the standards on auditing. So if anybody asks, how do I come to know that you have achieved the overall objective of SA 200? How do I come to know that you have done the audit as per the PSLR? Did we just discuss PSLR? Professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement. How will I come to know that you have done your work properly, that you've achieved the objectives of the engagement? Tell them, come here, sit down. And look at this audit file I have made. And now by looking at this audit file, can they check whether the overall objective of the audit has been achieved and whether the audit was planned and performed as per the standards and the legal regulatory requirements? So those are the main two purposes served by audit documentation. What are the main two purposes? Evidence of the auditor's conclusion about the achievement of the overall objective. And achievement of the overall objective. Like nowadays on the phone you have an app. Okay, how many steps did you walk today? So you know, you say I walked 10,000 steps today. So then you say, what is the evidence? You see, I have a tracker on my phone and it says that I walked 10,000 steps today. So you say, everybody, you know, I've achieved overall objective. On what basis you're saying you've achieved overall objective of 200? Audit documentation. You say, no, I did audit as per standards and legal regulatory requirement. How you're saying? You say, look at my documentation, you'll come to know. So these are the two main purposes served by audit documentation. And there are a number of the additional purposes also served by the documentation. One of the exam, what question they ask? Audit documentation serves a number of additional purposes. Oh my God. And I'm not asking you the main purposes, but only asking you the additional purpose of the audit documentation. So what are the additional purposes served by audit documentation? One, it says it assists the engagement team to plan and perform the audit. Then it also assists the member in the engagement team to do the proper DSR. What is DSR? Direct supervise and review the work. It also enables the engagement team to be accountable for the work done. Right, so accountability for work, how it can be fixed? It can be fixed on the basis of the documentation. Okay, who prepared this working paper? Mr. B. Okay, then Mr. B is accountable. So accountability for work done. Also, what does it say? It's a record of matters of continuing significance for future audit. So next year you have to go for an audit. What you took previous year file, you take it with you. Right, so record of matters of continuing significance for the future audit. Then also quality control reviews and inspection, that is all the SQC one monitoring. How they do the monitoring? They look at your audit file. How they monitor your work? By looking at your audit file. And also external inspections, like, you know, say some peer review of ICAI or quality review of the quality review board. How they do? How that external inspection can be done? Again, what they review in that external inspection? They review the audit documentation. Right, so what are these? These are the additional purposes served by audit documentation. What are the additional purposes? It assists in planning and perform the audit. It assists in DSR. It enables the engagement team to be accountable for the work. It also keeps a record of matters of continuing significance for the future audit. Also the conduct of quality control reviews and inspection and the external inspection. Right, these are the additional purposes served by audit documentation. Right, if anybody looks at this audit file of mine, by looking at the audit file, what all should be there in this audit file? Right, form, content and extent of audit documentation. Again, the 3 points which I taught you in the definition. What are the 3 points I taught you in the definition? Anybody looking at my audit file, they should understand what were the, right, the audit procedures performed, right, sorry, right, the audit procedures performed, the audit evidence obtained and the conclusions reached. Are you understanding that? anybody. So it says, what is there in this file? So again, what you'll say, what procedures I perform, what evidence I obtain, and what conclusions I reach. In what audit procedures I perform, what should be there a record of the characteristics of whatever the items or matters which were tested. Who performed the work, which date, and who reviewed the work, and again, as on which date. Right, so anybody looks at my audit procedure, they should also understand what were the items you tested, which debtor, which sales you test, who did the checking, which date, who reviewed this work, and as on which date. Even that should be there in my audit file, right? They asked a retail question on the first one. Right, in the nature of audit procedures, what documentation is required to be kept, right? In the form, content, and extent of audit documentation, and in that nature, timing, and extent of the audit procedures, right? The nature, timing, and the extent. And there are some additional matters which can be included in your documentation. What is the main matters in my audit documentation? Audit procedures perform, audit evidence obtained, and the conclusions reached. In addition to that, what can also be there in my audit documentation? Matters which I discussed with TCWG, any inconsistency in the other information. So that is actually SA 720, which is actually not in your syllabus. You just have 710. Then what does it say? Auditor departed from a requirement of a SA. Any particular standard on auditing you could not follow, or any new audit report in exceptional circumstances after the date of the audit report. So that is SA 560. That is SA 560. Right, so these are the additional matters. What are the first three matters which should be there in my audit documentation? Procedures perform, evidence obtained, and conclusion reached. And in addition to that, what are the four more matters? Matters communicated to TCWG, any inconsistency in the other information, any departure from any SA, and exceptional circumstances, any new procedures perform after the date of the report. Okay. Next question. Factors affecting the form, content, and extent of audit documentation. Right? Factors affecting the form, content, and the extent of the audit documentation, right? So what are the factors affecting? Like, you know, I have done audits of two companies. Which two company? Geo Limited and Mio Limited. Just giving you an example. One file is 2 TB file and another file is a 212 MB file. Why? Okay, one is 4 box file and another is 1 cardboard file over there. Why? Okay, one file is so big and one file is so small. Are you understanding? The factors affecting the form, content, and extent. Again, a 5-star question. CA final asked 2 times. So, you can expect it to come out over here. Right? Factors affecting. Do you understand the difference in the question? What was the first question? Form, content, and extent. Now, the question is factors affecting the form, content, and extent. What are the factors? Why one client file is 4 TB, 2 TB, and another 212 MB? Because the client is big. That is why the file is big. So the size and complexity of the entity. Next, same story. What is same story? Procedures perform, evidence obtained, conclusions reached. What we studied in the definition. Audit, procedures perform, evidence obtained, conclusion reached. Next, what does it say? RMM identified, exceptions identified. More the RMM, bigger the file. More the exceptions, bigger the file. And last one, the audit methodology and the tools used. Right? I made use of data analytics. Obviously, file will become small. I did manual checking. File will be big. Right? So the audit methodology and the tools used. Are you understanding factors affecting the form, content, and extent of the audit documentation? It depends upon the size of the client. The size of the client decides the size of my file. Are you understanding? Then procedures perform, evidence obtained, and conclusions reached. RMM identified, exceptions identified, and the audit methodology and the tools used. Right, timely preparation. Preferably, if I have to issue the date of, if I have to issue my audit report on 25th of April, as and when I finish the checking, immediately should I document or should I document it later on? You say, no, first 20 days I will do audit, and then from 21st to 25th I'll document. No, as and when I do the work, I should be documenting. Why? Because if it is documented later, it is likely to be less accurate than documentation which is being prepared at the time the work is performed. As and when I do the work and I document, it is going to be more accurate as compared to I say, no, let me finish all the work, then I will sit down and document. It says it is going to be less accurate than the documentation being prepared at the time when the work is being performed. Are you understanding that? Okay. Next one, documentation of significant matters. Again, a 5-star question at intermediate level. Right, it says what you need to document. We saw these 3+4 points. Did we see these points? 3+4? Form, content, and extent of audit documentation. Okay. Now, what does it say in your audit file? What was this last point over here? Documentation of the significant matters. So, what do you mean by the significant matters, right? Documentation now of the significant matters. Are you getting that over here? Right. So, again, a question on the right, if you see the question over here, it is the documentation of the significant matters, then documentation of the professional judgment. So now we are talking about two documentation. Which two documentation? Documentation of significant matters and documentation of the professional judgments. Right, so like what we had studied in internal control chapter today, what we had studied, significant risk for NRT, non-routine transaction, and significant risk for judgmental matters. Likewise, now what we are studying, documentation of the significant matters and documentation of the significant professional judgment. Okay, documentation of the significant matters. Okay, what could be the significant matters over there? Obviously, first significant matter is matter which give rise to significant risk. Then second, matters which might lead to the auditor's conclusion that the financial statements could be materially misstated or there is a need to revise the auditor's RMM. Or there was a significant difficulty in applying an audit procedure, or the findings of the auditor could lead to a modification or an emphasis of matter paragraph. Are these significant matters? What is a significant matter? Matters giving rise to significant risk, or because of which you think that the financial statements are materially misstated, or there is a need to revise the RMM, or there was a significant difficulty. So are you seeing the word significant? Significant. Then after that, what does it say? Findings that may lead to a modification or which may lead to an emphasis of matter paragraph. So this is documentation of the significant matter. In SA 701, we study key audit matter. In SA 706, we study emphasis of matter, other matter. Here we talk about significant matters. Right? Documentation of the significant matters. Then documentation of the significant professional judgment. What is significant professional judgment? The rationale for the auditor's conclusion. When a requirement manager provides that the auditor shall consider certain information and that consideration is significant, that you know whether the company should make a provision or a contingent liability. It's a very significant matter. And on what basis auditor said, yeah, yeah, this is not a provision, this is contingent. Or no, no, this is not a contingent or it is provision. So what was the brain you applied? Brain means the rationale which you applied for the same. Next one, the basis for the auditor's conclusion for the reasonableness of the areas of subjective judgment. Like again, talking about the accounting estimate, whether 10% debtor provision is enough or 12% or 15%. So how did you make that professional judgment? It says it should be documented, right? So one, documenting the rationale. Second, documenting the reasonableness on areas of the subjective judgment. And then also, what does it say? Considerations about the authenticity of a document, right? Which may require you to use the work of an expert. Okay, client has given you the minutes of the meeting or they've given you some contract with related party. You say, I don't know how true this contract with related party is. Right, so concerns regarding the authenticity of a document. Right, so rationality, subjectivity, and the authenticity. And rationality, subjectivity, and the authenticity. Are you understanding that? Right, documentation of significant matters, documentation of the professional judgment. Then after that, ACM. Again, a question asked in your exams regarding the audit completion memorandum. Look over here. And an audit completion memorandum. So actually, when we start with the audit, we prepare the APM, audit planning memorandum. And when we are about to finish with the audit, we prepare something called as the ACM. What is ACM? The audit completion memorandum. What is audit completion memorandum? Right. Say you checked all items of the financial statement. One misstatement you found out in debtor, another you found out in inventory, one you found out in the share capital, one you found out in the related party disclosure, another is relating to the contingent liability, another is related to the loan. So are these misstatements there in different items of the financial statement? Will they be there in the respective working papers over there? Are they all scattered in the audit documentation? Right, so what does it say? Now prepare a summary. Summary of what? All these significant matters that you identified during the audit. Did we just discuss significant matters? Like say in my example, there are 7 significant matters. So what does it say? What is ACM? A summary of all the significant matters, all the big matters, issues which you found out in the audit. Then whether for that matter are you modifying your opinion, whether management agrees to correct or not correct. So how the matter has been addressed. And say this is the matter regarding inventory. Now where more information I can get of that matter? Say I1. What is I1? The inventory working paper. So that includes the suitable cross references as to where the related information can be found in the audit documentation. So if the partner, he wants to come to know okay, what all are the findings in this audit, no need for him to go through each and every paper. What he can do? He go through the ACM, he comes to know everything, what are the findings of the audit. What is ACM? It is a summary of all the significant matters identified during the audit, how they were addressed, and that includes the cross references. Right? It's the crux. It's the, what do you say, the crux of all your findings in the audit. So now the partner, does he need to go through the entire file? No, he can just go through the ACM, the audit completion memorandum. So obviously what is the advantage? It gives the advantage of doing the efficient effective reviews. It is the summary of all the significant matters. And again, any essay you are unable to achieve the objective, you can mention it in the ACM. Right? You can mention it in the ACM. Has a question come from this one in the exam? Yes, audit completion memorandum, right? The audit completion memorandum or the audit summary memorandum. Look at some question, no giving any intimation that I am coming. And how they give an intimation? By telling about it in the RTP, MTP, study material of ICAI. Then at least we know that coming. This again, all of a sudden guest coming home. And that type. All of a sudden, not announcing that you are going to come or anything. Just what is the rule? It is in the syllabus. Okay, so that's the audit completion memorandum. What is an audit completion memorandum? It is a summary of all the significant matters, how they were addressed, and that includes the cross references as to where the related information can be found in the audit documentation. Right, then what is the date of the audit report in my example? 25th of April. Example. So now this date, if you see the audit file, it is almost done, but little bit here and there is left. So whatever that little bit here and there is left, it should be completed within not more than 60 days after the date of the audit report. And whatever assembly of the final audit file you're doing within not more than 60 days, it is only an administrative process. And during this administrative process, can you delete or discard any documentation before the end of its retention period? No. What is the retention period? 7 years. Right. However, can you make changes which are administrative in nature? Yeah, administrative changes can be made. What is an administrative change? That deleting the old documentation, superseded, giving cross references of working paper, signing off the checklist, documenting evidence that has been obtained. So this administrative work, can it be done within 60 days after the date of the audit report also? Yes. But can you reach a new conclusion? Can you draw any new conclusion? Can you perform any new audit procedure after the report has been issued? No. Because report is already gone. Now you're just doing your back-end processing. So that is merely an administrative process. Can you delete old documentation? Yes. Can you do the referencing of the working paper? Yes. Can you give the signing to the completed checklist? Yes. Can you document the evidence you've obtained? Yes. What you cannot do? You cannot perform new procedures. You cannot reach new conclusion. Why? Because report is already gone. Report has already been issued. Now within 60 days after the date of the report, you are doing the assembly of the final audit file, right? So again, assembly of the final audit file, assembly of the final audit file. And obviously audit documentation, it is whose property? It is the property of the auditor. He may at his discretion make portions or extracts from his documentation available to the client. This is favorite one for correct and incorrect. And SQC 1 SA 230, what is SQC 1? Quality control, which talks about engagement documentation. Right, so as per SQC1, engagement documentation is whose property? Audit documentation whose property? As per it is the property of the auditor. But client is asking, okay, CA, can you give us your audit plan? Auditor says, no, 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 no. There's no question of I giving you my audit plan. Client says, CA, we had given you the rent agreement, no, when you were doing the audit. And what happened? No, we lost our original rent agreement, but you have a copy with you. So can you give it to us? CA says, that I can. And he may, at his discretion, make portions or extracts from the audit documentation available to the client, provided such disclosure does not undermine the validity of work performed. So if they ask me for my audit plan, I will say no. If they ask me for my audit sample, I will say no. But rent agreement minutes of the meeting, it is theirs only, so I can just give it to them. And what does it say? Provided such disclosure does not undermine the validity of the work performed, or in case of an assurance engagement, the independence of the auditor or his personnel, but it does not affect the independence of the auditor. The auditor is telling client all the significant risk and all the RMM which has he had identified in the audit. Again, not right. Right, so what is that? The ownership of the audit documentation. Please tell me the sentence. As per SQC1, audit documentation is the property of the auditor. He may add his discretion make portions of or extracts from audit documentation available to the client, provided such disclosure does not undermine the validity of the work performed, or in case of an assurance engagement, the independence of the auditor or office personnel. Right, the independence of the auditor or office personnel. Right, so that is the ownership of the audit documentation, and that completes our discussion for, yes, SQC 1, SA 220 and the SA 230. Is it clear to everyone? Audit documentation and the audit quality control. Now coming to the next one over there, audit strategy, audit plan and the audit program. Okay, right. So yes, as you had a a concern over there that how do I revise that one day before the exam or all day before the exam. So now we have made our notes over here, no? Like we know ke SQC 1, SA 220, at the beginning of the chapter only what I can write over here, Lehem. And L-E-A-H-E-M. Then audit documentation is what? Audit procedures perform, audit evidence obtained and the conclusions reached. This is like the crux of what is over there. Right? Then for SQC 1, what are the two objectives? Professional standards and the legal regulatory requirement, reports issued are appropriate. And then you have each of the element of the quality control system. And for audit documentation, we have the, what is audit documentation? What is the reason why audit documentation, nature and purpose of audit documentation, then the form, content and extent, then factors affecting, you know, file size, the form, content and extent, then after that the two documentation, documentation of the significant matters and documentation of the professional judgment, the significant professional judgment, then you have the ACM. What is ACM? Audit completion memorandum, then the assembly of the final audit file. What is the assembly? Not more than 60 days. It is only an administrative process. You cannot perform new procedures. You cannot draw new conclusions. And again, you have to retain it for 7 years. And what changes you can do? You can do changes which are administrative in nature. And these are the examples of changes which are administrative in nature. And retention period, 7 years. And whose property? It is the property of the auditor. Right, clear to everyone. So again, you know, the more again and again you read the chapter, you can, your frequency, what you say, your time required for studying that chapter reduces over there. Right, the time will reduce over there. Okay, and now coming to the next chapter, which is the audit strategy, the audit plan and the audit program. Okay, right, audit strategy, audit plan, and then also talking about the audit program. Okay, so now again what we will do, we will follow reverse strategy. Reverse strategy means first we look into the audit program, right, then we'll come to audit strategy and audit plan. Okay, right, so one question for audit program is the definition, the meaning of the audit program. Are you all with me? Yes, audit program, the meaning. Then after that, is it possible that, you know, your CA firm is doing 400 audits during the year, and for all 400 audit, only one audit program? evolving one audit program, is it practicable for all businesses? You say not practicable for all businesses. Right. Then what does it say? Once an audit program has been given to an assistant, to a team, audit team member, is it that now no application of mind required? It says just shut your brain and just do what is written in the audit program. No, the assistant is encouraged to keep an open mind. So what is question number one? The meaning. Second one, one audit program for all the audit, not practicable. Then the assistant, should he keep a closed mind or open mind? He should keep an open mind. Then one audit program which I prepared in 2000, can I continue to use the same program when I'm doing audit in 2030 also? No. What does it say? Periodic review of the audit program. Then what are the points while you are constructing an audit program? Constructing, developing, now they've combined it together. Right? Constructing an audit program. Then after that you have the question regarding the audit program is designed why? In order to obtain the evidence. Obviously, why I'm designing the audit program? In order to obtain the evidence, right? Then a sub question of that is what are the broad types of the evidences? A sub part of that is what are the broad types of the evidences? Then after that, you have the advantages of the audit program and the disadvantages of the audit program. Everybody with me? Audit program. What is our program for discussion? We have to discuss 8 points. What is our program? For audit program, we have to discuss 8 features, 8 points. What are the 8 points? Definition. One audit program, not possible. Then, closed mind or open mind? Open mind. Then, one program ever? No. Periodic review of the audit program. Then, the construction is constructing an audit program. Then, the audit program is designed to obtain the audit evidence. Then, the advantages and the disadvantages of the audit program. Okay. Right. Now, what are the points over here? Audit program, if I come to the second part of the chapter over there, what does it start? One audit program? Not practicable. Then assistant encouraged to keep an open mind. Whether the attitude of the audit assistants is justified or are they required to keep an open mind? You say, please keep an open mind. Don't keep a closed mind. And also open mind. Then after that, periodic review of the audit program. Then the constructing and developing the audit program. So constructing, developing, now the points are combined over there. Then what are the broad types of evidences? Then what is the audit program designed to obtain, designed to provide the audit evidences? And then the advantages and the disadvantages. And also why go into the illusion of what is asked in the exam and what is not asked in the exam, right? What you can simply do, whatever is the content of the chapter you study, and you see some offbeat case study type of questions over there, those you can additionally read. And apart from this, in the correct incorrect also, like I'll tell you one question which they have made in the correct incorrect over there. What does it say? Under a properly framed audit program by the auditor, means you prepare a very nice audit program, the danger is significantly less and audit can proceed more systematically. Obviously, if you have a audit program which is prepared very properly, there is the risk is less, no, of you not doing a certain area or so. And can the audit proceed systematically? Yes. Can the audit proceed systematically? Yes. Now, where is this given? This is given in one of the advantage of audit program. Without a written and predetermined program, work is carried out on the basis of some mental plan. In such a situation, there is always a danger of ignorance or overlooking. And what does it say? If it is a properly framed program, then the danger is significantly less and the audit can proceed systematically. So what does it say? The danger is significantly less and the audit can proceed systematically. So that's one of the advantage of audit program which is asked in the correct and correct. And this is the asked in exam. This is not MCP, ISM or something or RTP. This is the asked in exam. Are you getting the point over there? Okay. Right. So now let's complete with our discussion regarding the audit program and then we will come to the right audit strategy and the audit planning. Are all of you with me? Right, so what is an audit program? What is an audit program? Right, audit program. Yes, audit program. What does it look like? A serial number, a name of entity, period of audit, all that. Then the particulars. Right, so serial number 1, area of checking, cash in bank? What are the audit procedure? Means our chapter of item of financial statement. And a physically verify the cash, BRS, reconciling item. Right? Then the timing, okay, when these procedures are going to be performed. So by what date they should be performed? Say by 12th April. Who is going to do this checking? Say Mr. A. And now whenever Mr. A finishes checking this area, he needs to sign. And then whatever are the observations of Mr. A, he can mention it over here in brief. So this is cash in bank. Then debtor. Right? For debtor, again, what are the audit procedures? By when the work should be completed? Say 15th April. Then who is going to do debtor? B. Then after that, again, whenever B finishes doing the work, he needs to put his signature. And what are the findings? Right, so for each and every item of the financial statement, what audit procedure, auditor you're going to perform in order to obtain the audit evidence? Obviously, why I'm performing an audit procedure to obtain a evidence? Why I want an evidence in order to reach a conclusion? That we studied in the definition of audit documentation also. Okay, why we perform a procedure to obtain the evidence and why we want the evidence in order to reach the conclusion. So now what is the definition of audit program? It's a series of verification procedures to be applied to the items in the financial statement or to be applied to the financial statements and accounts of a given company. Why you are applying these procedures? In order to obtain the evidence. And why you want the evidence? In order to enable the auditor to express an informed opinion. That means to reach a conclusion. Are you understanding? Audit program, it is a series of verification procedures to be applied to the financial statements and the accounts of a given company for the purpose of obtaining the sufficient evidence. Now, had they talked in the language of my standards, we would have said sufficient appropriate audit evidence. But this is sufficient evidence. Now, where to fight with them? Say you are right. Okay. It's a sufficient evidence which will enable the auditor to express an informed opinion on such statement. Right. So it's a list of examination and verification steps to be applied. Audit program is a detailed plan of applying the audit procedures in the given circumstances with the instructions for the techniques to be adopted. Right, so 2-3 alternative definitions given over there of what is an audit program. So any question regarding audit program, I can always start my answer by writing the definition. What is audit program? It's a series of verification procedures to be applied to the financial statements and accounts of a company for the purpose of obtaining the sufficient evidence to enable the auditor to express an informed opinion on such statements. Okay, right. Then is it so possible that for all business, under all circumstances, you're designing only one audit program? Right, is it possible? Right, now here again, you know this question, okay, one program for all business under all circumstances, what do we say? Not practicable. They ask it in the MCQ also. Evolving one audit program applicable to all businesses under all circumstances. Is it practicable? No, not practicable. So, correct. Then it is not necessary to periodically review the audit program. Incorrect. It is when a periodic review of audit program. So, same question. Is it coming in correct, incorrect, and theory also? Okay. Right. So, is it possible? Okay, when I have to do the audit of Infosys or State Bank of India or Tata Motors or Zomato, Nykaa, Myntra, I have one audit program. Same program I apply everywhere. Is it possible? No, because businesses vary in nature, size and composition. And each business is different. Second, work which is suitable to one may not be suitable to another. Right? So one, businesses vary in the nature, size and the composition. Second, work which is suitable to one business may not be suitable to another. Are you getting the point over there? Work which is suitable to one may not be suitable to another. Right, then also efficiency and operations of the internal control. Right, so business vary in nature, size and composition. Number one, work which is suitable to one business may not be suitable for another. Like Tata Motors, so much of inventory. Infosys, zero inventory. Work which is suitable to one business may not be suitable to another. In bank, I need to check for NPA. Obviously, for Tata Motors, I can't check RBI prudential norms over there. So work which is suitable to one business may not be suitable to other. Third one, the efficiency and operation of the internal control. And fourth one, the exact nature of the services to be rendered by the auditor. Are the factors that vary from assignment to assignment, and that is why it is not possible to have one evolving one audit program for all businesses under all circumstances is not practicable. Right? What are the four reasons? Business vary in nature, size, and composition. Work which is suitable to one business may not be suitable for another. Efficiency and operation of the internal control and the exact nature of services to be provided by the auditor vary from assignment to assignment. That is why not possible to have one audit program. Is it clear to everyone? Right. Then after that, assistant encouraged to keep a open mind. Should he have a closed mind or just keep his eyes closed and say whatever is written in program, that's it. Only that is what I'm going to check. I am not going to check anything in addition to what is written in the program. No, what you have to tell the assistant that whatever is written in the program, that is the minimum essential work. Right? Minimum essential work. Then again, the program should be altered to take care of anything which is left out originally. Say in the program, they have not mentioned about foreign currency bank account, but this company, it has foreign currency bank account. So should it be added to the audit program? Yes. Or say, you know, in this audit program, they have mentioned about foreign currency bank account, but your client does not have a foreign currency bank account. Then should it be dropped? Right. In that case, it should be dropped. So minimum essential work, what is not there, alter to include it, and what is there but not required, that you can drop. Are you understanding that? Auditor should frame a program for providing, aimed at providing at a minimum essential work, which is called as the standard program. As experience is gained, the program may be altered to take care of situations which are originally left out but which are found relevant. And if any work originally provided is unnecessary or irrelevant, it may be dropped. And that is why the assistant should be encouraged to keep an open mind. So what are the words you need to remember? Minimum essential work. Then any, can it be altered to drop out? Yes, to include anything which was not there in the original program? Yes. Anything which is unnecessary or irrelevant, can it be dropped? Yes, it could be dropped. So this is your open mind, right? So minimum essential work, then also alter and also drop. So can you do addition, deletion to the audit program? Yes. And when you keep an open mind, you can do the same. Right. Next one, periodic review of the audit program. 2000 ka program. Can you use it when you are doing audit in 2026 or 2030? No. So what does it say? Otherwise, you will end up doing your work on the basis of an obsolete program, and the CA may also have to face the legal consequences. And okay, you've done your work in a negligent manner. Right, so what you need to do, the periodic review of the audit program. How to do the periodic review? Inadequacies or redundancies of the program may be removed. So like, you know, in your 1990 program, it was written that auditor should check the casting, totaling. Now in 2030, do you need to check casting and totaling? No, it is all automated. Right, so inadequacies or redundancies in the program may be removed. Then also, what does it say? A basic feature of the audit program, it should give a few relevant instructions, like the extent of checking, sampling plan, and etc. Right? Sampling plan and etc. Right? So what are the points over here? Periodic review of the audit program. Right? So for periodic review, what is required is to continues to be adequate. You have to check whether your audit program continues to be adequate or whether your program is obsolete. If it is obsolete, you might also have to face the legal consequences doing the audit on the basis of an obsolete program. Then what does it say? Any inadequacies or redundancies may be removed. Then whatever is mentioned in the program is the few relevant instructions to be done. Then again, this is a case study which they ask over there. So one of the assistant, he thinks, oh, why this is written in the program, why they are writing, who checks it in today's world, who checks carry forward, brought forward, who checks casting and totaling, no, all this I'm removing from the program. What does it say? Article, don't be over smart. The program is not, so long as the program is not officially changed by the principal, every assistant deputed to the job should unfailingly carry out the detailed work according to the instructions governing the work. Then you think, I give so much idea, I'm telling you this is not required, but still, you know, they say I cannot make the change. Many people believe that this brings an element of the rigidity in the program. This is not true. Provided the periodic review of the program is undertaken to keep the program up to date as possible, and encouraging the assistants on the job to observe all the salient features of the various accounting function. Right? So if any article thinks that, oh, this is redundant, I need to remove this from the program, can they remove it? No, the program cannot be any changes unless and until it has been officially changed by the principal. right? Unless and until it is officially changed by the principal. So if you think this is not right, you tell it to your boss, and then boss can remove it from the program, right? So that's the periodic review of the audit program. Are you understanding that? Then now all these different points you have to write in the exam. An open mind, periodic review. Now they talk about the constructing an audit program, right? So obviously, what does it say? When do you start planning for your current year audit? The moment you finish your previous year audit. You start thinking about, you know, when you finish 25 ka audit, you start thinking, 26, when I will come for audit, I will do this, I will do that. So this we'll study in audit planning also, that audit planning begins shortly after the completion of the previous engagement and continues right up to the completion of the current engagement. Right? So obviously audit program is nothing but a type of audit planning only. Right? So what does it say? Audit planning ideally commences at the conclusion of the previous year audit along with the related program. It should be reconsidered for any modification. Again, auditor has to decide whether he wants to rely on the controls or not. And further, auditor normally has the flexibility in deciding when to perform an audit procedure. I can decide, first I want to check debtor, or first I want to check creditor, or share capital, sales or purchases. I can decide, no, 12th April I'll check sales, 13th April I will check purchases. So generally it says auditor has a discretion ke when he wants to perform a particular audit procedure. But some cases he does not have a discretion, like 31st March 3 p.m. when client is going to do the inventory count. Will you have to go 31st March 3 p.m. only? Yes. So what does it say? In some cases, auditor may have no discretion, like, you know, when he wants to observe the taking of inventory by the client personnel, then 31st March 3 p.m. only you will have to go to attend the inventory count. Right, then for the purpose of program construction, the following points need to be kept in mind. So this is the initial theory for constructing an audit program, and then after that you have these points. Okay, now you're constructing an audit program. What are the points you will keep in your mind? Okay, so now say you want to construct a building. Okay, so now what you have decided, will you first prepare the print of what you say, the layout of that building, right? Whatever building you want to construct, are you going to prepare a layout of that building, that this is the design of the building, it is going to be a 7-floor or 8-floor building over there, right? Each floor is going to have so many offices or so many shops and so or restaurants over there, right? So I'm just giving an example of constructing a building. So now what we have to construct over here is an audit program. So obviously first, if my audit is for 1 year, my program should also be for 1 year only. If I want to construct a 7-floor building, the plan should only be for 7-floor building. So one, what does it say? Stay within the scope and limitation of the assignment. Right? Stay within the scope and limitation of the assignment. Then should you have a written audit program? Yes. Right? Should the CA have a written audit program, or it should be all just a mental plan? No, there should be a written audit program. Then he needs to decide, like say for construction of the building, now you'll require the cement, you'll require the rods, you'll require the labor. So what you have to decide, okay, what could be the, what all raw material you will require, and what is the best price and quality of the raw material I can get. So here also you have to check, okay, which is the evidence which is reasonably available, and identifying the best evidence. Right, so like identifying the raw material labor, here you have to identify the evidence and what could be the best evidence which could be obtained. Then obviously now I need to apply only those procedures which are helpful in achieving the objectives. Right, so apply only those steps and procedures which are useful in accomplishing the verification purpose. So obviously now in this building, I will purchase only those products which I require for constructing the building and nothing else apart from that. Right, so here also, what does it say? Apply only those procedures. Then include the audit objectives for each area, and also there should be clear set of instructions regarding the assistants who are involved in doing the work, and consider all possibilities of error. So now when you're constructing the building, are you going to, you know, first do the digging under the ground, you know, why? So that if any earthquake or so takes place, you know, your building does not move over there, right? Also there should be good quality construction of the building. So obviously when I'm doing an audit also, should I consider all possibilities of error? Yes. Should I coordinate the procedures to be applied to related item? Like say if I'm checking cash, I'm going to check receipt, payment, all transactions relating to cash at the same time. So if I'm doing the electrical wiring of the building, now wiring of all floors, we'll do it together only. Right, so coordinate the procedures to be applied to the related items, right? So that is the constructing an audit program. What are the points? Stay within the scope and limitation, then also determine it should be a written audit program. Then after that, what does it say? Evidence which is reasonably available and the best evidence. Then apply only those steps and procedures which are relevant for your purpose of the audit. Then what does it say? Include the audit objective for each area and the assistants who are involved. Consider all possibilities of error and coordinate the procedure to be applied to the related items. Right? Nowadays, this is trending in the exam, constructing, developing the audit program. Right, constructing, developing. Okay. Then after that, it says audit program is designed to obtain the audit evidence. Why do I design an audit program? In order to obtain the audit evidence, right? So what does it say? What are the procedures and technique? Again, they've given the example of sales. For sales, what evidence auditor would like to obtain? Invoice, price list, forwarding notes, inventory issues, sales manager advice, and the acknowledgement of the receipts by the goods for the customers and the collection of the money. Right, so audit program is designed to obtain the evidence. Again, you need to check what evidence is reasonably available. Generally, for sales, we would like to get the following evidences, and these are the broad types of the evidences. Right, so documentary examination, physical examination is nothing but your inspection. Then explanations from management, third party is nothing but your inquiry. Right, then mathematical accuracy, then state of internal control, accounting data, subsidiary memorandum, records, minutes, and the subsequent action. So again, this I don't know whether to put it in 500 or to keep it in audit program. Yes. No, they ask what they can ask. If they ask it, then it is you have to write in your own mind. But I've never seen in an audit paper where they ask you something where you know you have to write an answer with your own mind. You think it's a question as per your own mind, but they ask something from the syllabus only. Rather, why they've asked sales? Because somewhere it is included in the study material. That's why they've asked sales. So generally, at least I have not seen it. Okay, they're asking some different question over there. Okay, right, so that's the broad types of the evidences, and then we come to the advantages. So you know, those of you who are referring to the study material, you find it a very immaterial heading over there, or some just some extra information given over there, but that extra information is coming as a question in the exam, you know, that additional information that was as per the old. You have an old study material, right? Yeah, so that was in the old one. Now in the new one, they have combined constructing and developing. Yeah, they've combined both of them together. What they did, developing ka point, they put it before the construction over here. I don't know what changed their mind, because earlier they had constructing an audit program, developing an audit program separately. Then they said, no, combine. So that is how it is. Okay, right. Then after that, so you should be happy, no? At least one burden less. Okay, right. So anyway, same. Okay, right. So now coming to the advantages and the disadvantages. What are the advantages? Number one advantage of an audit program. Did you see the program I prepared over here? This program did I prepare over here? What is the number one advantage? Now, no headache, no confusion. Who has to do the work? What work is to be done? How cash and bank is to be checked? Is there a confusion? No. Then you said, no, nobody came and told me that I have to do cash and bank. I never knew it has to be done by 12th April. I did not know that I have to check all this regarding cash and bank. You can't say any of this. Why? Because when it is written in the program, that means it is an instruction given to you that this is what is required to be done. It's like instruction. Nobody needs to come and tell you separately. It's like the instruction. Then obviously, will the audit program ensure that all work is covered? Total perspective of the audit? Total work is done, all areas are covered. Obviously, this program we'll prepare. Will it be for all the areas? Right, so obviously in that case, there will be no ignorance or the overlooking. And there won't be any ignorance or the overlooking. Right? Then now you know, okay, oh, cash and bank is to be checked, and you know, inventory is to be checked. Can you also identify which are the people whose name you should write against that area? Do you know, oh, this person is very good with cash and bank, this person very good with inventory? So selection of the assistants. Again, tomorrow anything goes wrong with cash and bank, you know whose caller to catch? Obviously, professional behavior, you can't catch anybody's collar. But yeah, right? You know whom to hold responsible for the same? right? You know Mr. A, so responsibility can be fixed, right? Then obviously when I go for my future audits, what do I take with me? The previous year audit program, right? So again, it is a matter of reference, a record of matters for the future audits. On the basis of the program, can I track the progress of the work? Yes. And tomorrow, if anybody says, okay, auditor, you did not do the audit properly, what you are doing, auditor, can anybody say so? Right? No. Why, auditor? What defense is there with the auditor? Right? What defense is there with the auditor? The audit program. So it's an evidence in the courts of the law in case if a charge of negligence is brought against the auditor. It's a defense is evidence in the courts of law in case if a it's an evidence in the courts of the law in case if a charge of negligence is brought against the auditor. You know, so dare anybody say that auditor did not do the audit properly. Auditor says, just see how much audit program I prepared and how I did the work. Right. So what are the advantages? Number one advantage, instruction. Then total work, no ignorance or overlooking. Then selection of assistants and responsibility can be fixed. And then after that, you have the progress of work, future audits and the evidence in the courts of law. Okay. Then now what do you say? Oh, ma'am, if everything is written in the program, I was worried, you know, I will join a CA firm. They will tell me to check an area. And then I think I don't know how to check the area. No problem now. Why everything given in the program? Happily, I will just follow what is written in the program. So what is it? Mechanical work. Then another problem with the audit program is what? Okay, you know, okay, who checks this all? You know that, no, this is not proper. But what you know, I cannot make a change unless and until the principal officially changes the program. So it brings about an element of the rigidity in the audit program. And rigidity. Okay, you have to follow this. Right? Right. So one, mechanical work. Work may become mechanical and carry out the work without any understanding of the objects of the work. You know, without any understanding, not relevant, but just giving you an example over there. Like, you know, say there was a group of disciples and there was a, what do you say, teacher they had. And the teacher every day evening, you know, 5 o'clock used to take a meditation session for all the students. Okay, so when that meditation session used to happen, you know, then there used to be some cat which used to come at that time every day. You know, generally they have their one territory area and it kept coming every day. So obviously it, and it used to make its own sound. So all these, it used to disturb the meditation class. That is why what they started doing, okay, before they used to sit for the class only, they used to tie the cat at one place, and then they used to sit for the meditation. So then obviously the disturbance of the cat wouldn't used to be there. So then after few days, after few years also, this practice continued. What? Okay, whenever you sit for meditation, first you need to tie your cat. Now the original purpose of tying the cat was not that if you sit for a meditation, first you need to tie a cat. The reason that time was what? Okay, because that cat was disturbing, that's why it was tied. One day they wanted to do the meditation, no cat was there. So first they went to the jungle, found one cat, tied it, and then sat for the program. So you understand, you don't understand also. Okay, why? It's like, you know what they say as, you know, superstition or something like that. You don't even know, okay, why it is being done also. Anyways, what does it say? Without even understanding, did anybody ever ask, hey, when I have to do meditation, why do I need to tie a cat? No, you have to tie a cat before you sit for meditation. So without any understanding of the objects of such part in the whole audit scheme. And also mechanical work. See, why you're checking this? Or program may it is written. That's why I'm checking. Right? Then rigidity. What does it say? The audit may be, program tends to be rigid and inflexible. The business change in the client business may not be reflected in the audit program. Then, now they talk about two type of staffs. Which are the two types of staff in the CA firm? Inefficient staff and the efficient staff. Inefficient, they are dumb. They don't understand anything. And do you see the expression on their face? Blank. Never. You know, no expression on the face at all. Expressionless. Inefficient staff. Okay. But now this inefficient staff, nobody comes to know that they are inefficient. Why nobody comes to know? What they do? They look at the audit program. They look at the previous year audit file. And they do all the work accordingly. So nobody came to know that they don't know how to do the work. So they take the shelter under the audit program. And efficient staff, their CPU works very fast. Their brain, you know, it creates 1,000 idea per minute. But what they say, why to apply mind? No need. Whatever is given in program, just do that much. So it kills the initiative of the enterprising staff. So inefficient staff, they take the shelter behind the program, and efficient staff, it kills the initiative of the efficient staff. Right? So those are the advantages and the disadvantages of the audit program. Are you understanding that? And how to overcome these disadvantages? It says may be eliminated by imaginative supervision, encouraged to observe matters objectively, and obviously bring it to the notice of the supervisor or the principal. Right. So can you tell me what are the 8 headings for the audit program? Definition. One audit program for all businesses under all circumstances, not practicable. Open mind, then periodic review of the program, then constructing an audit program, then audit program designed to obtain the audit evidence. What are the broad types of evidences? One more question over there. Then the advantages of the audit program and the disadvantages of the audit program. Okay, right. Now coming to the audit strategy and the audit plan, right? So now coming to the second part of the chapter, which is regarding the audit strategy and the audit planning, which is the corresponding essay for this one. Essay 300. What is the title of 300? Planning and audit of the financial statements. Okay. What is the popular term they have over there? Auditor, you need to establish an overall audit strategy. You need to establish an overall audit strategy, which will guide you in the development of the audit plan. You need to establish an audit strategy, which will help you in the development of the audit plan. Right? What does it say? Audit strategy, audit plan are closely interrelated, and change in one will result into a change in the other. Right? What does it mean? If I change my strategy, I have to update my plan, and if I change my plan, I have to update my strategy. Generally, what will come before? Strategy. And strategy will be followed by plan. Right? Strategy, it will just give you the guideline of how you need to do the audit, and based on that strategy, now you will prepare your audit plan. Right? Based on the strategy, now auditor, you will prepare the audit plan. Okay. Now, if I want to prepare an audit plan, it says, okay, you have been appointed as the auditors of Infosys, and now prepare an audit plan. And you've never done the audit of Infosys before. And they say, CA, you've been appointed, start preparing the audit plan for Infosys. Can you prepare an audit plan without? No, strategy, okay. But you know, they say, prepare strategy, prepare plan for audit of Infosys. You have first time being appointed. You've never entered the gate of Infosys before this in your life. Can you prepare a plan without having a knowledge of the client's business, without understanding the entity internal control, without understanding the internal controls in the organization? Can I prepare an audit plan? No. Can I prepare an audit plan? No. Right? So audit plan to conduct an effective audit, but plan should be based on knowledge of the client's business, the expected degree of reliance on internal control, nature, timing and extent of the audit procedures, and coordinating the work to be performed. And then obviously my plan can be further developed and revised as necessary during the course of the audit. Right? So audit plan to conduct an effective audit. So for that, what should my plan be based on? Knowledge of client's business, the expected degree of reliance on the internal control, the nature, timing and extent of the audit procedures, and coordinating the work to be performed. And obviously, can it be developed and revised as during the course of the audit? Yes. Then what are the benefits of audit planning? Okay, why not just go and start doing the audit? Why first prepare a plan? Right? Why first prepare a plan? Because they say, no, if you fail to plan, you're planning to fail. Right, so very important for the auditor to prepare an audit plan. What do you think? It gives the roadmap. Okay, so exam question has come. Advantages of audit planning. What will you write? It gives a roadmap for the conduct of the audit. Anybody else, would you like to contribute? I am asking you a very simple question. I know all of you, there are two points in your mind. It will do the segregation of the duties. Wonderful. What about the others? You don't have any points. It will lead to the timely completion of the audit. Next. So how you'll write an exam? No, I am asking you what you're going to write in the exam hall. Question asked in exam is benefits of audit planning. What you'll write in answer, that I want. allocation of resources, okay. Okay, assisting engagement team members. Okay, assisting engagement team members. Then identifying important areas. You've delegated the task to me of writing your answer paper. So I'm just writing it for you. Identifying important areas of the audit. Theek hai. We can properly organize the audit. Properly, you're going to write this in the exam. Right? We can properly organize the audit. Or bolo, tell me more. Exam question has come. You see question number 3D. Briefly discuss the advantages of audit planning. 3 marks. Enough for 3 marks?
Deviation.
Deviation what? Are you talking about benefit or disbenefit? Advantage or disadvantage? You have to talk about advantage. You will write that. We can easily find out deviation. I am writing what you are saying. Huh? Easily found out the deviation if you don't follow a plan. Okay. This is what you think and which is right also, that these are the advantages of the audit planning. But you know, in the world, there are 3 types of answers. The right answer, the wrong answer, and the ICAI answer. Okay. This, what you have written over here, is the right answer. Roadmap. Roadmap. Is it ICAI language? No. ICAI language is AAPPEE. Appropriate attention is devoted to important areas of audit. Potential problems are promptly identified. Work is conducted in an efficient, effective manner. One of the students said, now identify the areas. No. Potential problems are promptly identified. One of you said, allocation of work. No. Selection of engagement team members. Right? Then DSR, direction, supervision, and the review, and coordinate the work done by other auditors and experts. So in an audit paper, do we need to memorize? Bluntly, I'm telling you, there is no other option. There is no other option. You have to memorize. Right, everybody, what is it? The benefits of the audit planning. What are the benefits? AAPPEE. Right, selection of engagement team members, DSR, and coordinate with the work of the other auditors and the experts. So what is it? Audit plan to conduct an effective audit. Then advantages of the audit planning. Sometimes I think, you know, you should buy, like, I'm not telling you, but you can just take your friend's book, 2 books, you know, so that one book you open the, like I have opened 2 files of the same book over here, no? 2 files I've opened. Why? In one file, I'm showing you the theory and how many times I go up and down, so simultaneously I've opened same file again, you know, again over there, right? So that we can immediately see, you know, so you can like also, you know, keep 2 books next to you, and then one you see what is the theory and then what is the question over there. Okay, right. So, you know, but I am telling you, even think before buying one book, because, you know, you unnecessarily will buy so many books, so many authors, so many publications, nothing going into the brain. Any author, any book, even institute study material, any YouTube channel, anything can make you pass, provided you study the correct way. And if you don't study the correct way, any material you use, you will not get the success in the exam. And please avoid overloading yourself with the content. Avoid downloading notes from Telegram. Very hazardous. You know, very hazardous. Not advice. You know, oh my God, look at, you have like so much, the entire data, you know, entire computer data or mobile data is filled with notes. Nothing over here. Taxation and all, it is unavoidable, but at least for theory subject, I don't know. Okay, right, so like I'm very thankful, you know, when I had written my exams, that time there used to be no abundance of information. We had no concept of anybody giving us amendment notes or anybody telling us what are the amendment or any revision notes or anything. You did a class, whatever material you got in the class, that's it. Then ICAI suggested RTP coming, you look into that, and also any study material of the institute you want to see, you see that. So very sorted. And it's limited material over there. Okay, right now also, the information is available, but how much of that you know, entertain and incorporate, that is within your hand. Okay, so audit plan to conduct an effective audit, right? Then advantages of the audit planning, AAPPEE, right? AAPPEE, selection of engagement team members, then coordinate, and also the DSR. Okay, then overall audit strategy, assistance to the auditor. What is the didactic sentence in this chapter? Listen, everyone. Overall audit strategy sets the scope, timing, and direction of the audit and guides the development of the more detailed audit plan. Repeat. Overall audit strategy sets the scope, timing, and direction of the audit. Scope, and okay, what all you're going to check, timing, when you're going to check, and direction, okay, how we are going to check it. Scope, timing, and direction of the audit and guides the development of the overall a more detailed audit plan. Okay, and now when you're establishing, huh, this is very favorite, that's what I made you write in the beginning also. Now, okay, what we do in an audit, establish audit strategy and then develop an audit plan. We establish strategy and then we develop an audit plan. So how to establish audit strategy? There the points they've written over there is the nature, timing and extent of the resources required to perform the engagement, and also the nature, timing and extent of the DSR. Okay, who, when and how much direction, how much supervision and how much review. Right, so the resources to deploy for specific audit areas, that means the resources, so experienced team members or experts. So that is the nature. Then after that, the amount of resources for specific audit areas, so that is the extent. And when these resources are to be deployed, at an interim stage or at the key cutoff stage, so that is the timing. Right, so nature, timing and extent of the resources and how these resources are managed, directed and supervised, when the team briefing meetings are held, also when the reviews are expected to take place. Right, so that is nature, timing and extent of the DSR. So nature, timing and extent of the resources, how much amount of, you know, what are the resources which you will require, then the amount of the resources and the when these resources are to be deployed. So that's nature, timing and extent of the resources, and then also the nature, timing and extent of the DSR. Are you understanding that, everybody? Overall audit strategy, assistance to the auditor. What question has been asked? Overall audit strategy, assistance to the auditor. Right, so the auditor shall establish an audit strategy. The auditor shall establish an audit strategy. The auditor shall establish an audit strategy. Like today in 240, fraud, what did I say? Ability to continue question, ability to continue performing the audit. You remember when we discussed 240, I had written over here somewhere, no? That brings into question the auditor's ability to continue performing the audit. Those were the important words in the question over there. Similarly, now what is the question over here? Establish the audit strategy. So first you have to establish the nature, timing and extent of the DSR, and then also the nature, timing and extent of the resources. Right? Nature, timing and extent of the resources and the, right, then the DSR. Okay, right. Then after that, next question. What is the next question over there? Preliminary engagement activities, right? So that's not there as such in the question bank. But what are we talking about is the preliminary engagement activities. What is preliminary? It says even before you prepare your audit strategy or audit plan. What is it? Preliminary. Even before you prepare your audit strategy or audit plan, first you need to do this preliminary work. What preliminary work you need to do? Issue engagement letter. Why in engagement letter, what I would have written? Preconditions. If they don't accept my preconditions, am I going to do the audit? No, then no preparing audit strategy or audit plan. Right? Also, I need to check whether I can comply with the ethical requirements, including the independence. I can't comply. Again, no doing the audit. Also, I need to check whether I need to whether I'm going to accept or continue this client relationship. Where did I discuss this with you? Essay 220. I decided I don't want to accept this audit. I don't want to continue with this audit. Will I prepare an audit plan? No. So that is why this is called as preliminary engagement activity. And now for an initial audit, what will be the additional preliminary activities? Initial, you know, first time when I'm doing audit. For an initial audit, what will be the preliminary activity? NOC, no objection certificate from the predecessor auditor, previous auditor. And because it is my first year of audit, I need to first obtain the knowledge of the client's business. What is this? Preliminary. So you say, ma'am, I have to prepare a timetable. Arre, before that, first you tell me, are you writing your exams in May 24 or November 24? Based on that, we will prepare your timetable. No. You say, ma'am, that I don't know when my attempt will come. Then now we can't prepare your timetable. First, that should be clear. You know, May 24 or November 24. Are you understanding that? That is preliminary. Before even you prepare a strategy or a plan. Right? So that is the preliminary engagement activities. Next one. In establishing the overall audit strategy. So now that's a different question. Your overall audit strategy, assistance to the auditor. And now what is the question? The establishing. So another variety of the question over there. Now what does it say in this? Again, this is a very favorite question. Establishing the overall audit strategy. How do you establish what you need to consider? One, the characteristics of the engagement that define its scope. So when I have to establish an audit strategy, what I need to consider? The characteristics of the engagement that define its scope. Then also, what are my reporting objectives? What will be my reporting objectives? True and fair view. You know, and I have to report to management, to shareholders and all of that. Then also, what does it say? Professional judgment regarding what? Okay, which areas effort is required to be put by the engagement team members. So professional judgment as to which areas are significant in directing the engagement team effort. See, engagement team, are they going to put equal effort for doing audit of all areas? No, where there is an RMM, where there is an SR, they will put more effort. So professional judgment as to which areas are significant in directing the engagement team efforts. Next one, the results of the PEA. What is PEA? Preliminary engagement activities. Right, the results of the PEA. So what is first one? Scope. Then after that, the reporting objective. Next one, professional judgment as to which areas are significant in directing the engagement team efforts. Next one, the results of PEA. Did I just discuss with you PEA? Right, the preliminary engagement activities and also the nature, timing and extent of the resources. Did we talk about nature, timing and extent of resources? Right, did we talk about this point? Retail question, nature, timing and extent of the resources, right? So these are the points. What are the points over here? Characteristics of the engagement that define its scope. Then the reporting objective. Then professional judgment, which area is significant. Results of PEA and the nature, timing and extent of the resources. This is regarding the overall audit strategy discussed in essay 300. Discussed in essay 300. We also have a standard essay 299, which is regarding the joint audit of the financial statements, in which now they talk about the joint audit plan. Okay, what are the factors to be considered in the development of the joint audit plan? So, you know, if it's a sole auditor, he knows entire audit I only have to do. But if it is more than one auditor, does he, what he knows, entire audit I don't have to do. I have to do it with some another firm. How many joint auditors could be there? Any number. Like State Bank of India, they have 14 joint auditors. Reliance, they have two auditors, right? So it's only two auditors over there. Are you understanding? So how many auditors could be there? Right? How many auditors could be there? More than one auditor. Then that is an instance of a joint audit, where more than one firm of auditors has been appointed. Like I told you, for Reliance, they have DTS and Associates and SRBC and Company. So more than one firm of auditors has been appointed. Right? Infosys, if you see their report, they have only one auditor over there, right? So they have the sole auditor for Deloitte, Haskins and Sells. So this is a sole auditor. Reliance is a joint audit. Are you understanding that, everyone? Okay, so now if one CA has been appointed, he knows I have to do the entire audit. More than one CA appointed, he knows I don't have to do the entire audit. The work has to be divided. How to divide the work? The work shall be divided by the mutual discussion, right, amongst the joint auditors. What basis? It says any basis which is mutually agreed upon by the joint auditors. What am I right now talking to you about? JAP. What is JAP? Joint audit plan. So mutual discussion, right? Then apart from that, right, so where is this discussion in our books? It is there in the chapter number 1, right, wherein we discuss essay 299. Right, so I'll just quickly come to chapter number 1 to essay 299. You'll immediately understand the reason why I'm discussing it right now. Right, so I'm talking about the joint audit plan, JAP. Right, joint audit plan. So how the joint auditors will decide the division of work? Mutual discussion. Certain areas of work they can decide, and certain areas of work which are important, they may decide not to divide. You also check, I also check, all of us check. Are you understanding that? Division of audit areas. So like say two auditors are there. Who are the two joint auditors? Says JN company and SN company. And an example. And then what they decided, you check balance sheet, I check P&L. And company has entered into a JV. They say that we don't divide. You also check, I also check. So there is division of audit area and there is common audit area. What am I talking about? JAP. Then what are the other points in JAP? Reporting objective. Then professional judgment, which areas are significant in directing engagement team effort. Results of PEA, nature, timing and extent of the resources. What I just discussed with you right now in essay 300. Reporting objective. Professional judgment, which areas are significant. Results of PEA, nature, timing and extent of the resources. And last point. Now see, is the work divided? Balance sheet, JN company and P&L, SN company. Just an example I'm giving over there. Now, each of the joint auditor, will he identify, assess the RMM for his area? Each of them. Now, will they identify, assess the RMM for their area? Yes. So, should it be communicated to the other joint auditors also? Yes. So, that's the sixth point over there. What is the sixth point? Each of the joint auditor will assess the RMM for his area and communicate to all the other joint auditors. Right. So, first point, unique. Last point, unique. Four points taken from essay 300. For joint audit plan, first point, unique. Last point, unique. And in between, four points borrowed from where? Essay 300. Are you understanding that? Okay. Recently, they asked a question in the exam regarding the joint audit plan. Right. So, if I come to the question bank, right, for 299. Joint audit. What does it say? Joint audit over here, November 2019. Right. They asked a question regarding the JAP. What is JAP? Joint audit plan. Right. Joint audit plan. So, 1 plus 4 plus 1. 4 comes from where? 300, and the planning. And then 1 is division and common audit area, which they need to decide by mutual discussion. Then each of the joint auditor will identify, assess the RMM for his area. Are you understanding that? Overall audit strategy, right? So that's the question over there regarding the overall audit strategy. Okay, right. So risk assessment we are done with. Right, so that was regarding the joint auditors. Okay, right, so here now we talk about the other questions. Now, what are the other questions that we have over there after the, right, so is this an important question? Establishment of overall audit strategy? Yes, and for this established audit strategy, nature, timing and extent of resources, do we have a routine question upstairs? Right? Does it give the assistance to the auditor? For that, we have a retail question. It gives the assistance to the auditor. So, in the exam, when they ask you establish OAS, what are the points you need to write? Scope, reporting objectives, then which areas more effort, results of PEA, and the nature, timing, and extent of the resources. Is it clear to everyone? What did I say? Just as in 240, we had a question, and a question regarding question about the auditor's ability to continue performing the audit. Here we have a question on the establish the overall audit strategy. So what are the points you write in your answer? Scope, then reporting objectives, which areas more effort, results of PEA, and the nature, timing, and extent of the resources. Okay, right, then audit strategy, audit plan. What does it say? Generally, strategy comes before, which is followed by a plan, but they are not necessarily discrete or sequential process, as change in one may result into a change in the other. So generally, strategy comes before, can they a little bit change here and there? Yes, there is always a possibility of the change. Okay, next one, description of audit plan. So now if anybody reads my audit plan, I say this is my audit plan. Now reading this audit plan, what they should understand, nature, timing and extent of the risk assessment procedure, nature, timing and extent of the further audit procedures and the other procedures to comply with the SAs, and also the nature, timing and extent of the DSR, right, regarding how the engagement was performed, right? So description of the audit plan, you know, what all I should consider while preparing the audit plan, these factors, establishing the audit strategy. And now based on that, when I prepare my plan, what should be written in my audit plan? Right, what does it say? Description of the audit plan, nature, timing and extent of the planned risk nature, timing and extent of the planned risk assessment procedures, nature, timing and extent of the plan further audit procedures, then audit procedures to comply with the SAs, and also the audit procedures, the DSR, how the DSR has been done. Right, so relationship between audit strategy, audit plan, then audit planning, a continuous process. Is it that one day you sit for 3 hours and you prepare an audit plan and audit planning is done? No, what did we say? It begins, it's a continual and iterative process. It begins shortly after the completion of the previous engagement and continues right up to the completion of the current engagement. So last year audit, say I finished on 25th April 2025, so from 25th April, and after that I start planning for my audit of 31st March 2026, and this planning will go on up to the last day I finish signing my report. So it begins shortly after the completion of the previous engagement and continues right up to the completion of the current engagement. Up to last day also I'm planning some or the other thing. So it's not a discrete phase, it is a continual and iterative process. Okay, and what does it say? When you're planning, you need to, prior to assessment of RMM, what you need to do? Obviously, first to assess RMM, I will have to do the risk assessment procedures. What are the risk assessment procedure? Inquiry, inspection and observation, and analytical procedure. So they divided it into 2 points. What do they say? Analytical procedures to be applied as risk assessment procedures, and the performance of the other risk assessment procedure. I can write 1 point only, risk assessment procedure. What does it say? Prior to assessment of RMM, what will you do in your planning? So obviously first I will do the risk assessment procedures, because then I will be able to identify the RMM. So what are the risk assessment procedure? Analytical procedures to be applied as risk assessment procedures and the other risk assessment procedure. Then also understanding the legal regulatory framework, determination of materiality. Why materiality? Because I have to identify the risk of material misstatement. So determination of the materiality and the involvement of any experts, right? And also the involvement of the experts. So what is that question? Audit planning is a continuous process. It is not a discrete phase, it is a continual and iterative process. And before even I assess the risk, what procedures I need to perform? Risk assessment procedures, determination of materiality, involvement of experts, and also understanding the legal regulatory framework. Okay, obviously audit strategy, audit plan, whose responsibility? It is the responsibility of the auditor. Can I go and sit in front of client and tell them, you know, I'll tell you what is our strategy, what is our plan? Can I tell them that first we are going to check inventory, then we are going to check fixed assets? That much I can tell them. Okay, first I'm going to check inventory and then I'm going to check fixed assets. Can I tell them, you know, these are the samples we've selected, this is the materiality, this is the significant risk? No. What does it say? You can discuss matters included in the audit strategy with the management, but care is to be taken not to compromise on the effectiveness of the audit, not to compromise on the effectiveness of the audit. And should the engagement partner and the other key members involved in preparing the audit plan? Yes, the engagement partner and the other key team members, should they be involved in preparation of the audit plan? 100% yes. Yes, it says only then it will be, their insights, their experience will help you to increase the efficiency, effectiveness of the audit. Right? So overall audit strategy, obviously whose responsibility it is? It is the responsibility of the auditor. But can I discuss elements of my audit planning with the management? Yes, but obviously what I need to take care, it should not compromise on the effectiveness. And should the key team members be involved in the planning of the audit? Yes, there should be involvement of the engagement partner and the other key members. Okay, right? The involvement of the engagement partner and the other key members, right? So changes to audit planning, right? So now that will come further, right? So overall audit strategy, can I make a change in my audit plan? Originally I decided to check 20 samples, then I decide to check 30, or originally I thought A will do this work, then I say B will do this work. Yes, what does it say? As a result of the unexpected event, changes in condition or the evidence obtained, can an auditor revise the audit strategy, audit plan? Yes, auditor shall update and change the audit strategy and the audit plan as necessary during the course of the audit due to unexpected event, due to change in the condition or the evidence obtained. Right, then now over here there is a question on the nature, timing and extent of the DSR. Right, nature, timing and extent of the DSR. One, what we studied, nature, timing and extent of resources. Now we are talking about nature, timing and extent of the DSR. Okay, you know in which cases you will have to do more direction, more supervision, more review. Right, it says it depends upon four factors. What are the four factors? SARC. What is SARC? The size of the entity. The more bigger the entity, the more the DSR. It depends upon the area of audit. For which area you will do more DSR? For cash in bank or for provision? Obviously for the provision, because provision is the most dangerous area in the audit, because maximum manipulation happens in the provision. Will you do more DSR for inventory or for cash in bank? Obviously for inventory, because inventory is a very critical item. Right, so it depends on the area of the audit. It depends upon the RMM. Right, RMM is high. More supervision or less supervision? More supervision. So it depends upon the RMM, and it depends on the competence and capability of the individual team members. First year article or qualified CA, for whom you will do more supervision? First year article, you know, for the first year article. So nature, timing and extent of the DSR. Okay, how much direction, how much supervision, how much review? It depends upon the size and complexity of the entity, the area of the audit, the risk of material misstatement, and the competence and capability of the team members performing the audit. Are you understanding that? Nature, timing and extent of DSR depends upon the SARC, size and complexity, area of the audit, risk of material misstatement, and the competence and capability. Right, when I have to document, as per documentation is 230, but as per SA 300, what I need to document? My audit strategy, my audit plan, and any changes made to the audit strategy or audit plan. What we need to document as per 300? The audit strategy. Then we need to document the audit plan and also any changes made to the strategy or the audit plan. So what you need to document as per SA 300? Audit strategy, audit plan, and any changes made to the strategy or the plan. And they've given the examples. And to summarize the overall audit strategy, then document the audit plan. In that you will document your risk assessment procedures and the further audit procedures and any changes made to the audit strategy or the audit plan. And it says your audit planning documentation should include the following. Right? The following thing should also form a part of your audit documentation. This is documentation for what? Your audit planning. This is documentation for your audit planning. Right? So can we just have a look of what we discussed in planning part one? What does it say? Audit plan is required to conduct an effective audit in an efficient and timely manner. How nicely they write. Why is audit plan required to conduct an effective audit in an... So not that you did an effective audit, but it was not efficient and not required so much time. Effective audit in an efficient and timely manner. Okay, so obviously plan should be based on the following factors. Then what are the advantages? AAPPEE, selection of team members, DSR and coordinate. Then overall audit strategy, nature, timing and extent of the resources. Then after that we have the preliminary engagement activities. Then establishment of the overall audit strategy. Super important question from this chapter. What are the points? Scope, reporting objective, which areas more effort, results of PEA, and the nature, timing, and extent of the resources. Then relationship between strategy and plan. Then the description of audit plan. Then audit planning is a continuous process. Then obviously whose responsibility? Audit strategy, audit plan, it is the responsibility of the auditor. Can I discuss elements of my planning with the management? Yes, but without compromising on the effectiveness of the audit. Okay, and then changes to planning? Yes, due to unexpected event, change in condition or the evidence obtained. And then DSR of the nature, timing and extent of the DSR. It depends on the SARC, right? The SARC, and then you have the documentation of the audit strategy, audit plan, and any changes made to the audit strategy or the audit plan, right? So we take a break, and after the break, first we do some MCQs, and then after that, we will look into the government audit. Okay.